Here am I.
Good morning. That's right. Young, stand and get ready to sing. From the dawn of creation, this world has been crying out for hope, for a hero to save us. We long for the supernatural. There is only one God who can save the day. Clear the stage, prepare the way. Heaven and earth are singing, glory, hallelujah. Let the whole world see the greatness of our God. An awesome wonder, he reigns forever. We know the greatness of our God. His power is endless, he lives within us. We know the greatness of our God. Oh, the greatness of our God. There's no one above him. Only our Savior wears the crown, that no one can stop him. Not even the grave could hold him down. But there is only one king that can save the day. Clear the stage, prepare the way. Heaven and earth are singing, glory, hallelujah. Let the whole world see the greatness of our God. an awesome wonder. He reigns forever. We know the greatness of our God. His power is endless. He lives within us. We know the greatness of our God. An awesome wonder. He reigns forever. We know the greatness of our God. His power is endless. He lives within us. We know the greatness of our God. Oh, 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 the greatness of our God. We stand in awe and wonder. All the honor is yours. We stand in awe and wonder. All the honor is yours, Jesus. We stand in awe and wonder, awe and wonder. The greatness of our God, an awesome wonder. He reigns forever. We know the greatness of our God. His power is endless. He lives within us. We know the greatness of our God. An awesome wonder, he lives forever. We know the greatness of our God. His power is endless, he lives within us. We know the greatness of our God. The greatness of our God.
The Lord is with you, he's with us. He rescued us, and he's happy about it. If you soak that in, you'll be moved by his love.
This world can be cold and bitter. Feels like we're in the dead of winter, waiting on something better. But am I really gonna hide forever? Over and over again, I hear your voice in my head. Let your light shine, let your light shine for all to see. Start a fire in my soul, fan the flame and make it grow. So there's no doubt or denying. Let it burn so brightly that everyone around can see that it's you, that it's you that we need. Start a fire in me. You only need a spark to start a whole blaze. It only takes a little faith. Let it start right here in this city, so these old walls will never be the same. Over and over again, I hear your voice in my head. They need to know I need to go. Spirit, won't you fall on my heart now? Start a fire in my soul, fan the flame and make it grow. So there's no doubt or denying. Let it burn so brightly that everyone around can see that it's you that we need. Start a fire in me. You are the fire. You are the flame. You are the light in the darkest day. We have the hope. We bear your name. We carry the news that you have come to save. Start a fire in my soul. Fan the flame and make it grow. So there's no doubt or denying. Sing it out. Let it burn so brightly that everyone around can see that it's you that we need. Start a fire in me. Start a fire in me.
Jesus, our Savior, said that the one coming after him, the one we have to guide us today, is the Holy Spirit. One way the Spirit can be described is as a fire. It burns in us. It moves us. It's such a critical part of our walk with God. And we are supposed to worship God in the presence and with the help of the Holy Spirit. Like a mighty wind, light the fire again. Come and breathe your breath on me. Like a mighty wind, light the fire again. Come and breathe your breath on me. Like a mighty wind, light the fire again. Come and breathe your breath on me. Like a mighty wind, light the fire again. Come and breathe your breath on me. Oh, oh, oh. Spirit, fall,
by the Son, Savior of the world, the hope for everyone. Oh, come, magnify the Son, Savior of the world, the hope for everyone. Oh, come, magnify the Son, Savior of the world, the hope for everyone.
Lord, as we stay in your presence, Father, I just ask that you will just bless us with your Spirit, Lord. That's what we want. If we want anything else today, God, I pray that you guide our hearts, Lord. Straighten us out. Draw our attention to you, Lord, and help us just crave your Spirit, restoration through your Spirit, Lord, and to be ignited to your will. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. I can't tell you how good it is to finally be here. It feels like we were planning for ages, and then, you know, some things kept happening, like a pandemic or the protests and all this stuff, and we didn't know if we were actually going to get here on time, but thankfully we are here, and it's wonderful. I just want to say thank you to everyone for welcoming us, for those who have welcomed us in person or online or helped us move in, all of those things. Thank you so much. We've appreciated the meals and your kindness. And I mean, as I was thinking about this morning and what to speak, I realized I know you guys a little bit, especially from getting to spend some time with you, but only a little bit. And it's always kind of hard to figure out, okay, well, who am I talking to and what are we talking about? But then I realized there are some things that all of us have in common, no matter what. One of those things is, I am going to take a wild guess that everybody here could say, you know somebody who is not a Christian. Unfortunately, I mean, I'm seeing a lot of heads nod because in our country, this is actually super common. It would be way more uncommon to say, I don't know anyone who's not a Christian. As I was preparing and digging in, I came across the statistic that America is the number one mission field right now. That's how far our country has come from. We used to say we are a Christian nation to now we are the number one mission field in the world. Other countries are sending missionaries to America because they see we have a great need. So I'm going to guess that you don't know just one person. You probably know many people. Like me, you probably have many people you grew up with in your family, people you went to school with, many, many people who are far from God. With that in mind, I also know that if you're here, you don't like that. You don't like that there are so many people who are far from God. We're not okay with this. We want to see people come into the church. We want to see people saved. We want to see lives changed. We want to see people become disciples. That's what it comes down to, is we want to see people become followers of Jesus. I know that is kind of the heartbeat of my ministry, and I think I could speak for my husband as well, is this is the call God has put on our lives, to see people come into the church. So I want to dig in this morning on how do we make disciples? That's the fundamental question a lot of us ask, is how do we make disciples? To do this, we are actually going to look at Matthew 28. I'm sure many of you know where we're headed with this, the Great Commission. We talk about it a lot. It has its own special name. But before I read it and before we really start kind of unpacking it, I want to point out one kind of important detail about this passage that sometimes we don't dig into. This passage we read, these verses, are the last words that Jesus speaks to his disciples before he ascends into heaven. So this is the last time they are gathered together These are the last teaching words that Jesus is giving to them. I don't know if any of you have been with someone as they're preparing to say goodbyes, whether it's, hey, I'll see you later, or whether it's somebody who's passing away, but last words are important. I was reminded of this last week when we left our church family we had been with for 3.5 years. There were tears, there were hugs, there were things that we needed to make sure that we said because we wanted them to remember. I mean, hugging your friends and saying, you know, I love you, I'll see you later, we'll come back and visit. Or I've been privileged to be with some as they have passed away or preparing for their last days, and they say what's important. So in my mind, this kind of brings out some of the importance of this passage. If you knew this was the last time you were going to spend with your closest friends, with Jesus was spending with his disciples, people he was sending out, these are the words he speaks before he ascends into heaven. So let's read. I'm going to read Matthew 28, starting in verse 16. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." The first answer to the question of how do we make disciples is we actually have to be a disciple. See, if you look at who Jesus is speaking to in this passage, he's speaking to the 11 disciples. Jesus could have appeared anywhere. He could have spoken to anyone. He could have drawn huge crowds to himself. He could have gone to the synagogue or Jerusalem and been the center of attention. But he asked his 11 disciples, the people who had learned with him for the last 3 years of his ministry, the people he had poured into, who had lived with him, who had seen him when he was speaking and also behind closed doors, who knew him better than anybody else. You guys come out to Galilee, to the mountains. The idea is away, because he had something to tell them. You see, there's importance placed here on being a disciple. My question for us is, are we being disciples?
or a few seconds before bed. But if we look in the Gospels, you will see time and time again, Jesus goes away from the crowd. He gets away. It'll say in the early morning, Jesus went off to pray. If you look at the night that Jesus was arrested, he was in the Garden of Gethsemane and he was praying. The disciples were there, but he went off by himself and he spent time alone with the Father in concentrated prayer. That is one of the marks of a disciple. We spend time with Jesus. The disciples got to spend time with him and just hang out with him and travel with him. For us to spend time with him, we spend time in prayer. That is how we communicate. We also spend time reading scripture. Again, Jesus did this, and the reason I can say this is because Jesus knew the scriptures. Now, some of you might be saying, well, of course, he was God. Yeah, he would know the scriptures. But if we look at the life of Jesus, he is what we call the 200% man. He was 100% God, but he was also 100% human. He came to earth to live like us. He was born as a baby. He grew. He experienced the trials and the tribulations that we experience. He also learned like we learned. You see, Jesus was able to quote scripture and was able to teach it and was able to reveal the deeper meanings because he spent time learning the scriptures. He spent time with his Father. He prayed. He read his Bible. There are other things he did we could point to when he was fasting in the wilderness and things like that. But some of the basic things to look at our lives and say, okay, am I really being a disciple? Or are we doing the things that Jesus did? Are we reading our Bibles? Are we spending time in prayer with him? Are we actively trying to grow and become more like him? You see, I can stand up here and I could tell you that I'm a vegetarian, but if I told you that and then I went down to the restaurant in town and you saw me eating a hamburger, were you going to believe me? No. I can say whatever I want to say. I can tell you what I want to tell you, but you're going to know what's true by the way that I act. So if I say, yes, I'm a follower of Jesus, but then you see me out doing something that I clearly should not be doing or saying something I clearly should not be saying, what does that say about me? Am I a disciple or not? We are faced with this question of, are we living the life of a disciple? Jesus could have appeared to the crowds of people, to the people who were wondering who he was. They could have appeared to people who were kind of like, yeah, Jesus was a prophet, but they weren't following him. But he appeared to the 11 who had sat at his feet, who had learned from him, who he had trained up to go out and do the ministry. Are we the people who have sat with Jesus and have learned from him and that we are allowing him to train us up to go out and be the people he has called us to be? This is the first step. If we want to see people coming into the church, or we want to see people coming to know Jesus, we have to first make sure that we are people who know Jesus and who are becoming more and more like him. The second answer to our question of how do we make disciples is a very simple word. He says, therefore, go and make disciples. Now, I've heard this passage preached many, many times, and I love this passage. You're probably going to hear it so many times, just heads up. But I want to focus in on the word go. Sometimes we get hung up and think that this passage is just for missionaries. If we are called to go, he says, go to all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We get this idea that it's to go to the world and to teach people there. But while that can be true, and many have heard those words and have felt that being true, that they were being called to some distant place, or like I was called to pastoral ministry, or many have been called to other areas of service, this word can also be translated in a slightly different way. It doesn't just mean go, it can mean as you go, as you are already going, make disciples of all nations. As you are already going about your life, as you are already going to work, as you are already going to school, as you are going to grocery shop, wherever you are going, make disciples. This is a passage that doesn't let any of us off the hook. I love how it just says go. It doesn't say if you are called to ministry. It doesn't say if you are called to a mission field. It doesn't say if you are under the age of 50. It doesn't say anything like that. It just says go. Remember, he's speaking to his disciples, to the people who are following him. If we follow Jesus, then we are his disciples, and he's speaking to us. He says, go. For some of you, that might mean God's calling you to a professional ministry, but for most of us, that's going to mean as you are going about your life that God has already called you to, make disciples. As you go to work, make disciples. We do this by how we speak to people, by how we treat people. It goes back to our actions, doesn't it? And to our words. It also says, go to all nations. Again, this can be all the nations of the world. We absolutely support missions in every country, but can it mean something more? What about all the people groups we have here in our country? What about the language barriers we have? What about the different ethnic groups? We're seeing so much strife right now, but Scripture says, go to all nations. Go to all people, all people. There's no people group that we're called to not reach. See, God wants a relationship with every person. So we are called to go everywhere and to everyone. So are we actively seeking to make disciples where we go? If you work with children, we're called to make disciples. If you work with adults, we're called to make disciples. No matter where we're going or what you're doing, we are called to make disciples, to essentially carry the word of Jesus with us no matter where we go. That doesn't mean we're always preaching a sermon, but it does mean that we're treating people the way that Jesus would treat them. We're speaking to people the way that Jesus would speak to them. We're loving the way that he would love. We need to make sure that we are going. Now, I mentioned in my opening that we are considered the number one mission field in the world. And when I did this research, I dug a little deeper than that to find out, okay, if we're the number one mission field, how many people would we say are not Christian? And the statistic I was finding first said 3 out of 5 people in the United States are not a Christian. But as I dug further and looked up more and more and more information, it actually suggests that it's closer to 4 out of 5 people do not have a relationship with Jesus. 4 out of 5 people are not actively walking with Jesus. The reason there's a difference in the number is because there are people who would say, I'm a Christian, but we're not living like a Christian. We would say we are culturally Christian. Does that make sense? Say, I'm a Christian, but we don't live in a way that in any way shows that we are Christian. So it says, in North America, where we live, 4 out of 5 people do not have a relationship with Jesus. This is why it's so critically important that we understand that this command is not just for those called to ministry. It's not just for a certain people group, that it's not just, it's inclusive for everyone. We are all called to go. We are all called to reach the people around us that we are able to reach wherever God has placed us, whether that's in a church or in a school or whether we're a stay-at-home parent. God has called all of us, and we are all responsible to take the gospel to all nations, to everyone. That's a pretty big, command. The last answer to our question here is, how do we make disciples? I love this. He says, and teach them to obey all that I have taught you. He doesn't leave this part out, because sometimes we get so focused on bringing people into the church that we just kind of, we get them to come in, and we kind of just, okay, I did my job, and we kind of leave them and we move on. And while that's good, we should bring people into the church, or we should take Jesus to them, however it works. It's not just about getting someone to say a prayer or getting someone to come into the church, but Jesus says, go and make disciples, baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and then teach them to obey. It's important that we're going and we're taking the gospel with us and we're teaching people what it looks like to be a Christian. We can't forget that part. So many times we think that somebody comes in the church that our job is done. But really, we're supposed to walk with them. We're supposed to help them learn what it means to be a Christian, to learn what it's like to serve Jesus, to help them understand that to be a disciple, we have to do the things like pray and read our Bible. To grow in our faith, we need to walk, as Matt said this morning, we have to mourn with those who mourn and praise with those who praise. We have to walk with people as they come in the church. Whether they come in those doors or we lead them to Jesus outside the church, we walk with them and we show them what it looks like to be a Christian. We show them through our actions and through our words, but we show them by being there with them. Christianity is not meant to be something we do alone, but it's meant to be done in community. We're supposed to walk with each other. It says iron sharpens iron. We can't do that by ourselves. When we bring people into the church, we need to be teaching them. We don't just drop them off and say, okay, see ya, my job is done, but we walk with them. We hold them up, and when they stumble, we are there. And then it comes around that when we stumble, they are there for us. Most of you have seen my children running around this morning. Joey's almost 9, Mira is 7, and AJ is 5. And I can't tell you the things that I have had to teach them that I thought that they should already know. Like when they were little, I remember teaching them, okay, you can't lick shoes. Mira liked to lick shoes for some reason. It was weird. Don't put your mouth on a doorknob. No, you can't eat the gum you found under the table at the restaurant. All of these things that to me, clearly, people should just know, they don't. My children, they're still learning. You have to hang up your towel. You know, all of these things. We take time to train our children because they don't know when they're little, when they're toddlers. And scripture talks about new believers, this they need milk, not solid food. We talk about them as infants in the faith. You can't just leave a baby alone at home because you don't know what you're gonna come home to. We have to walk with people and raise them up and teach them to obey all the things that Jesus taught us. We need to pour into them. We need to help raise up those we're bringing into the church. It's important for us to realize that people will see our actions and hear our words, and that's how they will learn to be a Christian. That's how they will learn to follow God. Are they seeing what we would want them to see? Would we want them to emulate us, to imitate us? Paul says, imitate me as I imitate him. Can we say that to people? Imitate me as I imitate him. Or do we have things we need to work on? You see, I know all of us want to make disciples. I know all of us want to see people come to faith in Jesus. That's one of the things that I love about this church. And the little bit that I know about you, I know that is your heartbeat. And if we want to do this together, then we have to stop and look at ourselves and say, are we being disciples? Are we first and foremost in our own lives, are we being the disciples that Jesus wants us to be? To answer these questions, look, are we practicing reading our Bible and praying those simple yet hard things that we are called to do? Are we being conscious to go, to talk to people, to go to everybody, to befriend people, to tell them of the love of Jesus? I don't mean you have to make every conversation a sermon. Nobody likes that. But are we taking Jesus with us in our actions and in our words? And when the opportunity does arrive, are we sharing the love of Jesus? And are we teaching those who come in, not just our children? That's important. We need to make sure we're teaching our children. We need to make sure that we're teaching our teens. We need to make sure that as new people come into the church, we are teaching them and we are helping them to rise up, to be the people that God has called them to be. This passage is for all of us. If we would call ourselves a disciple of Jesus, We are all called to go make disciples of all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and to teach them to obey. And I love what Jesus says at the end. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Well, some of this may seem scary or overwhelming, or we're not really sure how to do it. Jesus says, I am with you. I am with you. I am with you to the end of the age. No matter what happens, no matter if it's scary for us maybe to talk to people, whether it's at work or people who are different from us or whatever it is, Jesus says, I'm with you. We're never alone. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. So let us go and make disciples. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this morning and for bringing us all here to worship together in person. Thank you for the blessings you've poured out on us, Father. And I pray that as we go from here, that you would just speak to our hearts, Father. I pray that your words would ring true to us, that anything that's of me would fall away, Father. But we pray that your words would ring true in our minds and our hearts. Lord, may we be the disciples you've called us to be. May we go and may we make disciples and may we teach people, Father. We give you all the glory and we just pray your blessings on this place. In Jesus' name I ask, amen.
Let's stand and worship together before we go out.
Here I am before you, falling in love and seeking your truth, knowing that your perfect grace has brought me to this place. Because of you, I freely live my life to you, O God, I give. So I stand before you, God. I lift my voice 'cause you set me free. So I'll shout out your name. From the rooftops I proclaim that I am yours. I am yours. All the good you've done for me, I lift up my hands for all to see. You're the only one that brings me to my knees to share this love across the earth, the beauty of your holy worth. So I kneel before you, God. I lift my hands 'cause you set me free. So I'll shout out your name. From the rooftops I'll proclaim that I am yours. I am yours. All that I am, I place into your loving hands, and I am yours. I am yours.
Here we are, God.
Here I am, I stand with arms wide open to the one Son, the everlasting God, the everlasting God. Here I am, I stand with arms wide open to the one Son, the everlasting God, the everlasting God. So I'll shout out your name. From the rooftops I'll proclaim that I am yours. I am yours. All that I am, I place into your loving hands, and I am.
I want to thank the pastors today. thank you for Kim for introducing and sharing and just letting us get to know you guys a little bit today, Pastor Matthew. And I just thankful for everyone who is here. It's so nice to see the pews full, and we'll see you guys next week.